framework for this, it's funny, I thought about this a couple of years ago, and it really has worked out in terms of whenever we're going after politicians, but especially when we're going after companies. Because a lot of times, again, depending on you guys, but in the States, certainly on a gay rights issue, but also on maybe environmental issues, other minority issues possibly, there's a lot of issues dealing with companies and corporations that we've got a problem with, and we're trying to force them to change their position. Again, certainly environmental, but a lot of the other issues too. And I don't know if you guys have ever read or are familiar with the works of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who's famous, I believe, German writer or thinker, or actually doctor, who came up with this theory of dying. She had studied dying and came up with theory that there's five stages. And I have found that this is actually how it works, especially when you're dealing with companies, but even with politicians. But it's important because it helps you sort of think through the campaign as you're going kind of where you are. Her first stage is anger, her first stage is denial, excuse me. Denial, where people get cancer just say, no, I'm not sick, I'm not going to believe it, going to somebody else. And for me at least, whenever we've launched campaigns, again, against big politicians, big companies, what happens is the same thing that these guys described yesterday in their panel. For about the first week, they ignore you. And they just think, oh, it's going to go away. Oh, you're a blogger. You're just some kid. Nobody knows who you are. people will get bored. There won't be any damage. And they're clearly getting advice from their public relations people, but the advice is to just ignore it. Who is this woman? She's a blogger. Who cares? Second stage, anger. That's when they usually say something stupid. Because, again, they think you're not important. They underestimate you, and they usually say something dumb. They'll either put out a statement that denies the entire thing, but it's a lie, or they'll put out a statement that's even a little bit nasty going after you. Either way, one of the first mistakes I think to some degree a lot of these companies do, or even a politician, is actually putting out a statement, because it's usually very difficult for them to come clean and actually say, yeah, we screwed up, you're right, we're going to fix it, because that just kills it. I'm glad if they do, because it's done, but that just sort of kills everything, and they don't usually do that. So you're looking for them to make a statement because you can almost always find something in the statement that they got wrong, and then you put up another post dissecting the statement and explaining that they're liars, and now they're lying to their customers, lying to the community. What happens next, as I said, that was denial and then anger when they say something stupid. Bargaining is usually a couple weeks in when they finally realize that you're somebody. Either they'll talk to people in the community, again, like me back home, I don't have an organization. If I were to call a company first, which is what some people like to do, they say, before you launch this campaign against a company, shouldn't you call them and ask them about it and maybe see if they'll do the right thing? And even companies will say this to me after the fact, why didn't you call? And I've tried to call before, and I'm this blogger guy from Washington, D.C., calling, trying to tell them, I'm really very important, and you should listen to me or you're going to have a lot of pain, and they think you're an idiot. I mean, I've sort of stopped making the phone call because there's no way to do it without sounding like an egotist, and at the same time, they just don't believe you because they're used to dealing with organizations. But that's the bargaining phase, when then they finally kind of come around and say, what do you want? And they usually will offer you about, maybe half of what you want. But again, it's not really solving the problem. I won't go through the rest of it. The rest is depression and acceptance. But I think the first couple stages are, but it's true. It's really bizarre in dealing with them, though. You will see, these guys got me thinking about it again yesterday. You will see that initial period when they will just ignore you and hope you go away. And to some degree, that's almost the hardest part of the campaign because it's easy to sort of come up with, I believe in, one second, do you have a question? Sure. I'll just jump in. I've worked with a lot of people who want to launch these campaigns, meaning just any issue, like, oh, we've got to fight on this. Let's launch a website. Let's put out a statement or something. And I'm always like, okay, what's next? I don't want to have us launch this and look like idiots when five people come to our Facebook page, three people sign our petition, and then there's nothing next for us, and the company doesn't say a word, and there's nothing for us to do next. So you've got to figure out, even when you start these campaigns, you may not know every step as you go on, but you've got to have a vision to say, oh yeah, there's a lot of stuff we could do here. We could maybe get some people to protest this, or these guys did in England. They went and, occupied some grocery store. I mean, little ways of just kind of easy, but ways would embarrass the target. Did you have something you were going
to... Just one other thing that occurred to me. Wasn't that about the several stages you pass through?
Right.
Wasn't that something Gandhi used to talk about?
Oh, I don't know. I'd be honored if it were. What did he?
when dealing with the British colonial First they ignore you, then they fight you, and then they ridicule you, and then they fight you, and then you win.
Yeah, but it is interesting to see with the companies, and you kind of have to follow, and again, hope to God they make a statement, because they will screw up the statement, and then they lied, and oh, you know, everyone, they'll freak out when they say they lied, you know, because then the PR people are going nuts. I was trying to figure out, rather than just giving you, you know, examples of things we've blown up in the States, which I still think are useful, because we're still a few years ahead of you guys, I think, in terms of using the internet for sort of political activism, and it does help to see other examples. Even for me listening to these guys is interesting because I'm like, oh, that's interesting. You know, maybe we could apply that somewhere else. But I was also trying to think of sort of what lesson the different campaigns I've done are sort of based on. Here's a couple of them. You may have a story. You may have an incident. For example, this was a long time ago, like 1998, when I first started doing this on my own. I mean, I've been doing online advocacy for a couple of years, but I was on an email list for like gay news updates, because back in 1998, you still didn't have like a ton of newspapers online. You know, I mean, the New York Times still had this really simple front page and stuff. So a lot of us would subscribe to emails to get, you know, updates on any topics we cared about, and our friends would go through LexisNexis, you know, which is the pay service where you can search newspapers, and they'd copy them, put them in emails, and send them out to us, right? And I was on a gay rights list because that's what I cared about. And I saw an article from the paper in Hawaii, and a regular public newspaper, talking about a gay sailor who was being kicked out of the Navy under the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy, right? Our policy to, you know, we didn't allow gays in the military until just about the last year. And I was looking at it, and it said that he got kicked out because America Online had told the Navy who he was or something like that. And at the time, even today, but at the time I was thinking, you know, America Online was the big internet company back then, 12 years ago. I mean, they were it, or 14 years ago, especially in the States. Everybody had an AOL email address. Everybody had, you could create 7 different little names for yourself, you know, emails, and one was your work one was your friends, you know, one was maybe online dating name, you know, different little names you'd create. Well, it seemed to me, this sounds a little weird. What do you mean America Online gave away who this guy was? Like, people, you know, internet companies don't do that in the States unless, you know, you're a terrorist or something. So I went, and I think they put the guy's name or something. I went online on America Online and actually found him, sent him a little, you know, instant message back and forth, and asked him if I could, you know, help him out. I just said, I think this story sounds like there might be some news here. He said, sure. We talked by phone, and basically what had happened was he had created this profile on America Online without his real name, with his funny little pseudonym, you know, his fake name. And in it, he said he was gay, a sailor from Hawaii. Now, that's okay, even under the old anti-gay policy. As long as you didn't publicly say you were gay, you were okay. And since his name wasn't there, he didn't say it publicly. Well, he made a mistake through his work, and at one point signed onto his account and used the wrong email address to email the wife of a commander of his or something in the Navy. And she got this email and was like, who is this email from? What a funny name. And then saw, you know, Timothy on the bottom, and she thought, oh my God. So she thought the name was weird. She went into America Online, looked up the profile, gay. Tells her husband, they start an investigation. But interesting question as to whether did he say he was gay or not, right? Well, the Navy investigators call America Online and say, there's this profile, you know, Joe in Hawaii, I don't know. Can you tell us, is that Timothy McVeigh in Hawaii? They said, oh, yeah, it is. Just, they called the 800 number. The main number you call for service is the number they called. They said, yes, he's out. He's got 15 days now before he's kicked out, you know, 18 years working on a nuclear submarine as an engineer. And I told him, I said, I think we can blow this up. And my idea was, we'd already had a number of stories of gays getting kicked out of the military. The media tends to like them, interesting stories, but we've had a lot of them. To me, what was interesting was the online privacy angle. Because privacy was just becoming more of an issue, and America Online was a huge target. So I got his story, and basically I started, we didn't even use the web at that point. I just wrote up an email, a long email, that I sent out to my friends and reporters I knew, and the subject line was, is AOL violating your privacy? Because I knew it would get people's attention, especially back then. Now, you know, we get so many emails. And I just walked through what happened to this guy, and I started with the gay community, because, you know, for especially back in 1998, if you're a heterosexual, there's lots of places to go meet people. If you're gay, there really weren't that many to go in 1998. You know, you could go online to meet people, but there weren't that many bars. And if you're just coming out, you're kind of embarrassed about who you are, and you don't want to go to a public bar that says gay on it. I mean, it's hard to explain, but it's really a much harder experience. And people started going on the internet a lot because it was a lot easier, a more private way to meet people. So a gay person especially gets the, what do you mean? I'm finally like living my life through the internet safely, and they're going to tell my boss? Well, immediately the thing exploded. New York Times reporter got interested. A reporter with CNET got interested, which was already big back then, big online publication. And we just kept, another friend then jumped in and helped me, and we just kept getting more information from him and pushing this. Well, within about a week, America Online wasn't saying much. Within about a week, ABC News, which is our big, at the time was the big national news network, 11 million viewers a night, they picked up on the story. So they had him and me on, it was my first time like on TV, on ABC News, explaining the story. America Online was forced to give a statement. The statement they gave, of course, lied. It made no sense. So we jumped on that, and they started flipping out. And, I mean, the whole thing just kept building and building. Finally, a big lawyer got involved because they saw, oh, this is a good case, negotiated a massive settlement for the guy. I have no idea how much money, but he didn't work for years afterwards. And people have asked me. I never saw a dime of it, but he did pretty well. But it was a very interesting story. I won't go through all the examples now, but just to give you a few of the other lessons.